Dr. Walter Brueggemann is our Price lecturer for today. Dr. Brueggemann is probably the best known Old Testament scholar of his generation, and certainly I would say the most read of his generation among people who are not just scholars. He has written not just for the scholarly community, but for those of us who are trying to lead parishes and for those who are trying to live a faithful life. He's written over 100 books.
Wow.
And countless articles. He was on two different faculties in his time of teaching, Eden Theological Seminary and then the Columbia Theological Seminary. And when he retired from Columbia, they granted him the title of William Marcellus McPheeters Professor Emeritus, Old Testament. Samuel Wells, an Anglican priest who was at one time the Dean of Duke Chapel and is now the Vicar of St. Martin in the Fields in London, wrote a foreword to a recent collection of Dr. Brueggemann's sermons in which he described Dr. Brueggemann as a master exegete, a master theologian, and a master preacher. If you heard him this morning, you know about the latter, that he is indeed a master preacher. You're now about to find out that he is, in fact, a master exegete and a master theologian. To begin the lecture, though, I'd like to pray one of his prayers from a book of prayers he wrote called Awed to Heaven, Rooted in Earth. I think it's a good introduction for the topic today, which is about the exile, not only in the past, but the experience of exile in the present. It's a prayer entitled, Against Your Absence. All power, honor, glory be to you. You, sometimes hidden, silent, absent, unresponsive. We are so privileged that we seldom sense you hidden, silent, absent, unresponsive. But we know people who do. We think of places where you do not appear. We imagine you defeated, weak, held captive. And we wait a day, 2 days, until the third day. And then, most often then, quite reliably then, you appear then in your full glory. This day we pray against your absence, silence, and hiddenness. Come with full power into deathly places, and we will praise you deep and full. Amen.
Amen.
Please join me in welcoming Dr. Walter Brueggemann.
Well, I told Bill I've really been welcomed and introduced and introduced and welcomed. So I love being here. Since you quoted Sam Wells about my preaching, Bill, I preached at Duke Chapel once when Sam was there as the dean. And after the service, he said, I love your preaching. You have no style at all. And I'm glad to be with you. I always, before I retired, I always looked forward to getting to have a class at 1:30. It's such a high energy time. So I appreciate you, I think, being awake. So this is terrific. I'm going to talk a while, and then I hope we can turn this into a conversation. If we last as long as 3 o'clock, we'll do that. My wife says you never offend anyone by finishing early, so we'll see how that goes. But what Bill and I agreed on is that I would talk about exile, and I want to unpack that as a historical reality and as a metaphor. And as you will know, that when Jerusalem was destroyed in 587 BCE, Jews were displaced into exile, and maybe some of them came home in 537, it'd be 50 years. Maybe some of them came home in 522, maybe some of them came home with Jesus when he went out and got the lost sheep. That's what that means. It means exiled Jews. Maybe exile ended in 1948 with the state of Israel. Maybe it's not ended. So what we know is that the great imperial powers of the Near East practiced forced migration. They simply moved populations, and they moved Jews. And, that's what happened in Crimea, didn't it? They moved Ukrainians and they moved Russians in. That's what happened with Andrew Jackson and the Vale of Tears. We just moved Native Americans to where we needed them to be. And when you live in exile, you are a stranger in a strange land. Now, I want you to look at two texts, since this is supposed to be a biblical exercise. First of all, we'll look at Jeremiah 52. I'm going to do a little critical work, and then I'm going to talk about the metaphor.
590.
Page 590.
590, which is very close to 587. This is verse 28. This is the number of people who Nebuchadnezzar took into exile. In the seventh year, now what you need to know is that Nebuchadnezzar started in 605 BCE. That's when he came to power. So it says in his seventh year, that would be 598. Take 7 years off, you have 598. And he exiled 3,023 Jews. In his 18th year, that's supposed to be 587, you can check the math, he exiled 832 people. And in his 23rd year, that'd be 581, he exiled 745. And the text says if you add those three together, you get 4,600. That's all. Now, two things strike me about this. If you'll notice those four verses, look at that. The word exile three times. Verse 28, into exile. Verse 29, into exile. Verse 30, into exile. Into exile. First of all, you can observe what a small number of Jews that was.
Not many.
The other thing that strikes me is they knew to the last Jew, they kept track. They're kind of statisticians, because no Jew should be lost. Now, if you look at Jeremiah 24, those are the only two texts we're going to do right now. What happened after 598, 3,000 Jews were exiled, and many Jews stayed in the homeland. So there was an argument about who are the real Jews. Are the real Jews the Jews that live in Judea? Or are the real Jews the Jews that live in Babylon? And what we know is that the Jews that were exiled to Babylon were the leadership. The reason they exiled the leadership is that you won't have a rebellion against the empire if you siphon off all the leaders. So this is kind of, what would you say, riffraff. They're working people. So what happened is that this small number of elite Jews made the case that we're the real Jews. And the rest of the Hebrew Bible is dominated by the real Jews. So if you look in chapter 24, the way that works out in verse, it's a metaphor of baskets of figs. Could have been apricots, could have been anything. But verse 5, like good figs, so I will regard as good the exiles from Judah, whom I have carried away into the land of the Babylonians. I will put my eyes on them for good, and I will bring them back. And here's the verbs I showed some of you yesterday. I will build them up, I will not tear them down. I will plant them, I will not pluck them up. But in verse 8, the bad figs are the ones left in the land, and I will make them a horror, an evil thing, a disgrace, a byword, a taunt, a curse, and I will send sword, famine, and pestilence on them, God damn it. Well, Episcopalians have recently been through a big debate about who are the real Episcopalians. The real Episcopalians are the ordained gays? No, those are not the real, and so on. So who are the real Presbyterians? Who are the real? They're the ones that didn't argue about that, or the UCC, which is my church. They just say, whatever. So these people lived under Babylon. They lost the world of Jerusalem. They lost hope. They despaired. But now many scholars believe that the many Jews who stayed in the homeland were exiles in their homeland, because that also was controlled by the Babylonians. It became a Babylonian colony. And the reason you get a colony is for taxation purposes. So many scholars believe it's these Jews who constructed the Book of Lamentations, because the poetry of the Book of Lamentations describes the shambles of Jerusalem, and they had to see the shambles of Jerusalem every day. So all of this means that the dispute, two things, the dispute about the future of the Jews is mightily contested. And second, these people owned the microphones. They controlled the ideology, and so they said, if you're going to be a faithful Jew, you must think of yourself as an exile, even if you never left the homeland. So Jewishness equals exile, which means we have all lost our safe world and our displaced people. And you can see how that sense about Jewishness feeds Zionism in the state of Israel. It is the only place where we are not homeless. Now, that's what I'm going to say for now about history. But what I want to do now is to talk about exile as an interpretive metaphor. And whenever you turn a historical reference into a metaphor, it doesn't quite fit. So if you raise questions to me and say, I don't think this quite fits, I'm going to say, that's correct. I want you to know I knew that. But I can think of two ways in which this metaphor is a biblical lens for us as we think about our faith context. First, that we U.S. people are now losing our known world. It is slipping through our fingers, and it makes people angry, and it makes people nervous, and it makes people sad. Not everybody, but the opinion makers. So we are now facing the reality that U.S. muscle cannot have its way in the world because we can't finance it anymore. We spend ourselves into bankruptcy. We are, very many people are now concluding at the end of this miraculous economic growth that led to incredible affluence. So how many parents are now recognizing that their children are not going to be as well off as they were? So our outsized influence in the world is waning, and our sense of moral superiority is waning when we are honest. So it took President Putin some time ago to chide Obama by reminding Obama that there are many chosen peoples in the world, and almost every national community thinks it's the chosen people. We have a hymn about that, don't we, in which we sing about how we have wonderful blue skies, and the second verse jerks us around by saying, but many people have blue skies, something like that. So that's the first one, that exile may be a way of thinking about our displacement from the way we used to be able to think about our national community as God's imperial gift to the world. Second, the issue is acute for Christians. See if you agree with this. Because we now live in a world that is dominated by market ideology, in which the only thing that counts is to produce and consume and get your hands on lots of commodities and keep them for yourself. And the ideology of commodity is fundamentally hostile to the Christian virtues of hospitality, forgiveness, and generosity. I take as a sign of that our diminishment of food stamps recently, and our sense that the poor are not entitled to anything in our economy because they are not contributors. And that means that the dominant force of our society is increasingly impatient with the testimony of the gospel community, which to my mind means that the gospel community is in some sense an exilic community, the way the Jews were exiles in Babylon. Now the hooker in that is that many of us who are tenured or affluent, we don't experience much exile about that, but I'm talking about the primary commitments of gospel living are essentially unwelcome if they begin to get any traction in public life. So that's kind of my thesis about that. So I want to take exile as a way of thinking about the new place in which U.S. people are situated in the world, and the way in which Christians are situated in the market economy of the United States. Now, what I want to suggest is that the great crisis of exiles is that empires like Babylon are exceedingly impatient with local identity. And when empires can, they will erase local identity. So the Babylonians would, if they could have, they would have erased Jewish identity, and therefore the primary task of Jews in exile is to maintain Jewish identity. Mutatis mutandis, I want to suggest that a primary task of Christians in the United States and Christian communities is to maintain a baptismal identity that has public implications in a society that is fundamentally hostile to a baptismal identity. The dominant ideology of our culture would like to brand us by product and not by any religious icon that has to do with crucifixion and resurrection. I understand you can wear those crosses and nobody's going to tear them off our chest. But I mean, if you really try to practice anything by crucifixion and resurrection. So that's sort of what I want to talk about. And I want to talk about the situation of Jews to make three points before I get to my outline. The first point is that exiled people always partly yearn to submit to the identity that the empire wants them to have. So already in the story of the Exodus, they are one chapter out of Pharaoh's Egypt, and they want to go back. They want to go back because the empire has got all the goodies. The second text that I want you to see is in Jeremiah 29. I have a kind of a fixation on Jeremiah. In which Jeremiah wrote a famous letter to the Jews that had been carried away in 598. Jeremiah 29:4. Thus says the Lord of hosts to all the exiles whom I have sent into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon. Build houses and live in them. Plant gardens and eat what they produce. Let them be there a long time. Take wives and have sons and daughters. Take wives for your sons. Give your daughters in marriage and marry sons. But seek the shalom of the city of Babylon and pray to Yahweh on its behalf, for in its shalom you will find your shalom. So what the letter says is, accept your status as exiles, put your buckets down, and get accustomed to your new status, because you are not going home soon. And the third text that I want you to see is in Nehemiah 9. Nehemiah is way up front in the Bible. If you start with the Psalms in the middle and work backwards.
341.
What is it?
341.
341, Nehemiah 9. This is a very famous text, because beginning at verse 6, it's a long prayer on the lips of Ezra. And you may know that after a century, Ezra becomes the leader of the exilic community and really is said by the rabbis to be second in importance to Moses and is really the founder of Judaism. Judaism is an exilic religion. So his prayer begins in verse 6. But what I want you to see is verse 36. It's a quite long prayer. And Ezra now lives in the Persian period, so that's after the Babylonians, but it's pretty much the same. Here we are, slaves to this day, slaves in the land of promise. The land yields richly, and its yield goes to the Persian kings who've set over us because of our sin, and they have power over our bodies and over our livestock, over our economy. And we are in great distress because we're being taxed to death. So that's the context for what I want to talk about for strategies of maintaining Jewish identity. And you will understand, as I talk about this, I'm talking about strategies for maintaining baptismal identity. So I'm going to identify three strategies. The faith in exile has to be reformulated. You can't take it the way it was when we were safe in our own land and we were the dominant makers of ideology when we all lived in the Holy Land together. But we have to reformulate that now as outsiders. And the first strategy that I want to suggest to you is that they reformulated the remembered faith tradition. They didn't just reiterate it, but they did it with all kinds of interpretation. So if you look in Nehemiah 8, and you know where Nehemiah is, Nehemiah 8, is that, what is that?
340.
This is a very dramatic moment in the history of Judaism. In the seventh month, all the people, everybody see it, verse 1? All the people gathered together at the water gate, one of the gates of the city, and they told Ezra the scribe to bring the scroll of the Torah of Moses, and then it says he read it, and you can imagine then on the platform with Ezra, were all the impressive vestrymen in verse 4. They know all their names. Mattathiah, Shemaiah, Ananiah, Uri, Hilkiah, Messiah, and so on. You're lucky if you don't become the church reader and have to read that. And then it says in verse 7, help them to understand the Torah. So they read from the Torah of God, they read from the scroll, from the Torah of God, with exegesis. They gave sense so that people understood the reading. People in exile have to recover the tradition. I think that's why you got the year of the Bible. We've suddenly discovered in our midst, in the church, that there is a hunger to get reconnected with this old tradition. But if you've spent some time reading this old tradition, you know that you need some interpretive help with it. So then you have a bunch of sessions and then you get somebody to interpret it for you. So what scholars think, not all scholars, but many scholars think, the Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, that's the most authoritative Torah, was formulated in the Persian period out of old memory. It's a Persian document presided over by Ezra. the scribe. Scribes are people who make scrolls. So that the Pentateuch is not to be read as an ancient memory, but is to be read as an exercise in Jewish identity that is contemporary. So Genesis 1, about God created the heavens and the earth, is a liturgic argument that the world does not belong to the gods of the Persians or the lords of the empire, but the world belongs to the God who has long loved the Jews, the Jewish God who created heaven and earth, our God, our scroll, our rootage, our belonging. So the promises to Abraham now turn out to be, depending on if you could date Abraham, 600 years or 900 years or 1500 years later. One scholar has noted that there is such an absence of the mention of Abraham in the Bible before the Babylonian period, he proposes that it was invented in the Babylonian period. Maybe the Abraham tradition isn't even old, but we remember it as old. And what we remember about the promise to Abraham is that he promised us a land. So landless people are promised land by the mercy of God, which is a ground for hope that we won't be in exile forever. Or the Exodus narrative with emancipation from Pharaoh is not really about emancipation from Pharaoh, it's about emancipation from Nebuchadnezzar or from Cyrus or from Artaxerxes, because here we are slaves in our own land, helpless and powerless in the face of the empire. So the first big effort of Jews was to recover and reformulate and re-engage the tradition. And insofar as our kind of a church wants to sustain baptismal identity in the face of market ideology, what we are required to do by analog is to re-engage the tradition. We didn't have to engage the tradition as long as we were the dominant culture in the United States. And Jews didn't have to re-engage the culture as long as they all lived in Judea. But it is when we are displaced people somewhere else that the founding tradition keeps emitting identity so that we may remember who we are and have enough energy and enough courage to hold to our identity without giving it up. The second strategy for maintaining baptismal identity is to have a vision, so tradition, vision, that is deeply at odds with the vision of the Persian Empire. By and large, empires do not have any visions. They just imagine keeping doing what we're doing, but to do it better so it all stays in place. But vision is fundamentally a subversive activity because it imagines something other than what is in front of us. So Martin Luther King's I Have a Dream was a very subversive, dangerous statement because he's dreaming about our world being organized in ways other than it is presently organized. And of course, empires always have to kill dreamers because they're too upsetting. So third Isaiah 56 to 66 is an act of visioning, and Paul Hansen at Harvard has shown how the vision of 3rd Isaiah, which is a Persian document, Isaiah 56-66, is in deep conflict with the book of Ezekiel, that probably isn't quite that late. But here is an argument about what's the vision we have for the future. And as you know, I mentioned this yesterday in Isaiah 56, there is an argument about letting foreigners and eunuchs in. I think in the Episcopal Church there has been a big argument about who gets admitted to the communion table. I notice you say everybody comes. Our bishop in Cincinnati is not so hot on everybody coming to the table. He has a somewhat more rigorous view of that. Because, you know, if you let everybody in, first of all, pretty soon you won't know who's in. That's the verse in 56. Take a look at Isaiah 56.
Page 531.
This is the one that ends. The foreigners and eunuchs, you've got the verse 7. My house shall be, they're talking about the temple, shall be called a house of prayer for all people. And then look at this marvelous verse 8. Thus says the Lord God, who gathers the exiles of Israel, I will gather others besides those already gathered. So this is a vision of the great gathering God who envelops all of the exiles. In chapter 58, they had an argument about religious disciplines. And this is the text that we often quote during Lent. Is not this the fast that I choose, that you shall undo the thongs of injustice and give bread to the hungry and clothing to the naked, and invite your kinsmen, we translate, invite your homeless kinsmen into your house. It's a very radical notion of fast that doesn't have to do with giving up watermelon for Lent. Well, maybe some of you do. But the first part of that chapter, we often do not read, is about religion that has become pro forma. Day after day, you worship me, verse 2, and you delight to know my ways. And you say, well, how come we fast? It doesn't seem to be working. Verse 3. And then the zinger at the end of verse 3, you serve your own interest, but you don't pay minimum wage. So it's an argument about a religious fast that has to do with the practice of economic justice. That's not what Ezekiel tend to argue. Ezekiel tend to argue about a very spiritual kind of discipline of holiness. So the issue was joined about that. And then I mentioned yesterday in Isaiah 65 this vision of a new heaven and a new earth and a new Jerusalem, which means you're not going back to the old Jerusalem. And then out of that, in Ezekiel, I mentioned yesterday, you get the vision of a new temple. I didn't say yesterday as we were talking about Ezekiel, if you look at Ezekiel 47, this is after the water coming out of the altar.
634.
634.
Ezekiel 47, 13. Thus says the Lord God. I mean, pay attention, this is from elsewhere. These are the boundaries by which you will divide up the land for inheritance. This reads like the book of Joshua, only it's much more precise because now it's very mathematical and symmetrical. and you get the boundary of the land on the north side and the east side, and then he goes through tribe by tribe into chapter 48. So this is a vision among exiles of a newly ordered promised land. So you can imagine the reordering of this most blessed land of amber waves of grain that will be reapportioned in symmetrical, ordered ways for the whole family of God. And then I pointed out that the very last phrase in the book of Ezekiel, the new name for the land is not Palestine or Israel or Judah, but the new name of the land is Yahweh is there. Now clearly this is not a program for how to get back to the land. This is a vision. This is a vision that keeps exiles living in confidence that the way we got it now is not the way it's going to stay, because God is faithful. And out of that you get a new covenant, you get a new Messiah in Jeremiah. Now you know how to find Jeremiah right in front of Ezekiel. Chapter 23, verse 3. Then I myself will gather the remnant, that means homecoming, and I will bring them back, and I will raise up shepherds, that means kings. The days are coming when I will raise up for David a righteous branch, because David's line ended in 587, and the new king will execute justice and righteousness in the land, and in his days Judah will be saved, and Israel will live in safety, and the name that will be given is the Lord is our righteousness. All what they do is to take the old traditions and they process them and turn them into future expectations that is not simply a reiteration of the old, but now is turned into a wondrous promise of new possibility. I suppose we would say today a new possibility that is given by the Lord who can turn blindness into sight. This is a God who can make all things new. Because of this God, nothing is impossible. So, tradition, vision, and discipline. You cannot maintain a distinct identity in the empire without intentional disciplines. Disciplines that draw the line and distinguish people in the sub-community of exiles from the people who dominate the empire. So let me give you a title of a book by Michael Fishbane, which is entitled Sacred Attunement. Fishbane is a Jew who teaches at the University of Chicago. And this is a nice little book that talks about how Jewish disciplines get Jews in tune with the sacred reality of God. And what Fishbane says about these disciplines is that they keep us mindful of being Jews. And he says if we do not keep these disciplines, we will soon forget that we are Jews. And he says it's in the book, it's very important to remain mindful because we live in a mindless culture. And so there are wonderful short chapters on Sabbath
and kosher and circumcision and ritual baths. So, as you know, if you try to talk to a Jew about theology, Jews will always say, we don't do theology, we do practice. We perform bodily visibilities that our children can see. So here's a tale about kosher. In Daniel 1, Daniel and his nine Jewish friends are in training for civil service appointments in Babylon under Nebuchadnezzar. Most people think it's a story from the second century, long after Babylon, but that's okay. Babylon, Seleucids, the Ptolemies, they're all the same. If you've seen one empire, you've seen all empires. And they're like the Ohio State football team at training table. They had really great food every night because Nebuchadnezzar wants them well-fed and glowing and really looking healthy. And Daniel says, I can't eat that. I'm a Jew. And if I eat goy food, I'll be defiled. I will compromise my Jewishness. And training table guy says, I can't let you do that because if it doesn't work, they'll kill me because you have to look good. And Daniel says, let's just try it for a week. Isn't it amazing that Daniel knew that kosher food was really healthy and says what he ate was water and vegetables. Not even any carbs. I don't use the word for carbs. But it worked for a week, and so the guy let him do it. At the end of the training program, Nebuchadnezzar comes and pins medals on all of them. And the narrative says that the Jews who kept training table were the handsomest and healthiest and best looking and most competent of all of them. So what interpreters think about Daniel 1 is you can live under Nebuchadnezzar. You can even cooperate with Nebuchadnezzar as long as you don't forget who you are. But the way you remember who you are is by practicing these visible disciplines that are inconvenient. When I read that, I always think, is it different for you? I don't mind dying for Christ, but I don't want to be inconvenienced. The other discipline that I want to mention is that they practiced economic justice. So I want you to look at Nehemiah 5. Now there was a great outcry of the people and of their wives against their Jewish kin. Not against the Babylonian and the Persians. For there were some who said, with our sons and daughters, we got big families. We must have grain so that we can eat and stay alive. But we are having to pledge our fields and our vineyards and our houses as collateral to the bank in order to get money to buy grain. And there were those who said, we are having to borrow money on our fields and our vineyards to pay the emperor's tax. Our flesh is the same as these rich, accommodating Jews. We're kinfolk. Our children, you see, what happens is the empire does not intervene directly. It always finds locals who will cooperate to advance in the empire. So it's Jews against Jews. Our children are the same as your children. And yet, we are forcing our sons and daughters to be slaves. And some of our daughters have been raped. And we are powerless. And our fields belong to others. Does that sound contemporary? Nehemiah says, I was really upset. So after thinking it over, I think this is the place where the Hebrew says, I took counsel with myself. And I called in the people who were forcing the taxes and said, you are taking interest on loans from your own people. You are violating the book of Deuteronomy. And I called a great assemblage and I said, we have bought back our Jewish kindred and have sold them to other nations, and now you are selling your own kin. And they couldn't think of a thing to say. And I said, this is not good. Let us stop this talking about interest. Restore to them their fields, their vineyards, their olive orchards, their houses, and the interest on money, grain, wine, oil. And they said, okay. And he required a compact between the creditors and the lenders, because they're all Jews. What had happened to the ownership class of the Jews is that they started acting like Persians. They started imitating imperial modes of wealth extraction. And Nehemiah confronted them and said, you have to decide about your Jewishness. And the Jewish Torah will not permit you to treat your neighbor Jews that way. Well, does that remind you of the story of Zacchaeus in Luke 19? When this Jewish tax collector, and he says to Jesus, if I have cheated anyone, probably I will repay them fourfold, which is an old Torah provision. And Jesus says to Zacchaeus, who had forgotten who he was, he's a Jew taxing Jews in service to the Roman Empire. And Jesus says to Zacchaeus, come down. I'm going to eat at your house because you know what he says? You are a son of Abraham. And Zacchaeus said, really? I had forgotten that. I had abandoned my identity. So Jesus is inviting Zacchaeus back into his true identity, which requires him to participate in the economy differently. So, tradition, vision, discipline. I propose to you, if you will entertain the thought that we are a church in exile, which is a little hard to imagine, but Trinity. but Trinity is in exile. If it is serious about its gospel mandate and butts up against market ideology, first thing you know, you have people cutting their pledges. Because it doesn't sound like you're resonating with the dominant economy or whatever. But this is really the conversation that the church now has to have about how do we recover and reinterpret our tradition. So you're working at that with the Year of the Bible and many other study teaching venues. And what's happening to very many people in our society is that we are discovering that the dominant narrative really doesn't work, and we're having to fall back on more elementary narratives that tell us who we are. I know we Episcopalians recite the Nicene Creed every Sunday, and some of you must surely be like me. You're so preoccupied with getting the words right, you don't pay too much attention to what we're saying. But it is a normative narrative in which we believe that the narrative of the Father and the Son and the Spirit that culminates in baptism for the forgiveness of sins and the life of the world to come, which doesn't mean heaven, it means the world organized differently, it's the true narrative of our life. And I think what we have to pay more attention to than we do is that that true narrative of our baptismal life is in profound tension with the narrative that our society wants us to inhale. Because all the television ads are about imagining that you can get another car or another drug or another beer or another cosmetic that will make your life right. Everybody believe that? We know better than that. But we don't remember that unless we are engaged in active work about reinterpretation of the tradition. Vision? I said some of that yesterday, and I won't repeat all of that, but I think, what will the world be like toward which we live? And I only say two things about that, which you already know. One is that the biblical tradition, in its main flow, is massively inclusive of the other. I give you the title of a book by Martha Nussbaum. It's called The Clash Within. She teaches also at the University of Chicago. And it's an answer to Samuel Huntington. You may know that quite a while ago, Samuel Huntington wrote a book called The Coming Clash of Civilizations, in which he said there's going to be a huge clash between the West and Muslims. And Martha Nussbaum writes the book to say that doesn't have to be true. Martha Nussbaum spent a year in India, and she interviewed Muslims and Hindus about the clash of Muslims and Hindus. And she came to the conclusion that the clash was not between Muslims and Hindus. The clash was between people who couldn't tolerate the other and people who could risk honoring the other. So her book is entitled The Clash Within. And on the last page of the book, she says, every one of us carries that clash within us. Every one of us, in some ways, wants to welcome someone who is unlike us. And every one of us is scared to death of those who are unlike us. And how we negotiate that clash determines what kind of a society we can have. You can trace that clash right through the Bible between the inclusive people and the exclusive people. So the vision of a society that welcomes the other is huge. I have a Jewish friend, you may know his name, Mark Braverman. He has taken up the Palestinian cause. He's a Jew, but he says that the Jews made a defining mistake when they rejected Jesus and the embrace of the Gentiles. And when they rejected the embrace of the Gentiles, Judaism, he says, became a tribe. So what we're getting is tribal religion. Well, that's true of all of our communities of meaning. If we put the wagons in a circle, we become a tribe under threat. One of the disciplines is othering. And the other one is obvious, that the disciplines of exilic baptized community is an economy of outrageous generosity. I heard a stewardship sermon at St. Philip Cathedral in Atlanta, which is very affluent. And the dean brought in someone who did the stewardship sermon. And this guy was urging generosity, and he said he was riding with a woman who passed a guy begging on the street corner, and she handed him a $100 bill. And he said to her, you know, he's just going to drink it up. And she said, I'm not on that committee. So if it is true, as we baptize people, confess that we were dead until we were given the second life in Jesus of Nazareth, then the right response to a second life that is a gift is have it. It's a discipline. So we have to talk thirdly about disciplines. And the conventional disciplines of the evangelical community are prayer, fasting, Bible study, regular assemblage. I have come to think, projecting out of my own life, that the hardest of the Ten Commandments is the Sabbath commandment. Because the market ideology wants us to be available 24/7. And if we're not on, we feel left behind. So at lunch we were talking about how Sandy Koufax refused to pitch in the World Series on Sabbath day. So Sabbath day, whenever you keep it, Sabbath day is a regular visible discipline, so that our children and grandchildren can see that our lives are not defined by the production and consumption quotas of the empire. And it is the hardest thing to unhook. It is the hardest thing to unhook from the empire. So I think those are the three conversations that we ought to be having in the church. I want to mention two books and then I'll stop. A very difficult book by Bridget, I don't know how you say it, Kahl, K-A-H-L. It's her doctoral dissertation, so it's very hard to read. She's German. I think the book is in English. It's called Reimagining Galatians. It's the most extraordinary book I've ever read in the New Testament. You may know that the big critical dispute about the book of Galatians is whether Galatia is Northern Asia Minor or Southern Asia Minor. Did you know that? They won't preach. Kahl makes the argument that Galatia is not a territorial term. It is an attitude of dissent. So Paul's letter to the dissenters. And you may know that Paul goes on and on in Galatians about don't trust the law, but grace. Now what we've taken that to mean is it's an anti-Jewish attack on Jewish legalism. Everybody said that since Luther. What Paul argues is that the law that Paul is talking about is the law of the Roman Empire. Don't obey the expectations of Rome. It's an amazing argument. The other book that I want to mention to you is by a scholar I just heard of named Ian Street. He spells his last name with two T's at the end. As near as I can figure out, he's a conservative evangelical. The book is entitled Subversive Meals. It's a book about the Eucharist, in which he says that the Eucharist is an imitation of Greco-Roman banquets, when they ate and then they sat around and sang songs and drank and told stories. And that the Eucharist is a subversive act of contradicting those banquets by meeting regularly for a meal of defiance in the presence of Jesus. I found it, without being a New Testament scholar, I found it a very compelling and informing argument. That book is not so technical. You can follow that argument pretty easily in that book. So if it is true that the baptismal community among us is in exile, and that our conversation is about reformulating the tradition, articulating an alternative vision, and thinking through what disciplines will sustain us, then that means that every assemblage of the body is really an urgent one about how do we continue to be us, and how do we articulate our peculiar identity in visible ways in the life of the world. And I think that's what the Ezra community had to struggle with. And as you follow the Ezra community down toward the time of the New Testament, you can see that it was a highly disputatious community, because they continue to have arguments about what the real tradition was, what the real vision is, and what the right disciplines are. None of that dispute is necessary if we just imagine that we are a part of the dominant culture. But if we have to do homework under the radar, then that kind of requirement is fairly important and fairly heavy-duty. Well, let me stop there and see whether you want to engage this. Yes?
Let me indicate how we're going to do questions today. I'm going to give you a microphone, you're going to name your name, and then you're going to ask your question.
Is that what I'm going to do? I'm Barta Flanagan, and I wanted to take you back to Jeremiah. And you'd cited 23:5. And my question is about the line, "The Lord is our righteousness." What does that mean?
Well, righteousness means active engagement to make the world right. And I think that means God is actively engaged to make the world right. Now, I think probably in context, it's simply a royal slogan, meaning, because it goes on to talk about the new king, and the new king is to act that out. Does that make sense? Well, a righteous person is not simply somebody who is good and pure, but a righteous person is one who has energy and capacity to maintain a transforming presence in society. And I think in that text, this is first of all an identification about how God is among us, and then derivatively, how the new king is to act that out. Want to come back at that?
So to be righteous,
to be righteous, I don't know the Hebrew.
Tzedakah.
Is to be a transformative presence?
That's right. Okay. Yep. The thumbnail sketch of the, well, there are two thumbnail sketches of the righteous man. One is in Psalm 112, and two things that I remember it says in Psalm 112 is that he does justice, and the other one says he's unflappable. He didn't get all upset when the market collapses, because he has made other investments. And the other one is, the other famous one is in Job 31, in which Job recites how he has cared for widows and orphans, how he has not hoarded gold, how he has looked after his servants, how he's really done it all. Now, you know what the poem of Job goes on to say is, I don't care. God says, I don't care. But that's what it is. Yeah, right.
Thank you.
So that in Christian confession, Jesus is the righteous one, because go tell John that everywhere I go, blind people see, lame people walk, lepers are cleansed, deaf people hear, dead people are raised, good people dance, poor people dance. Go tell John that everywhere I go, life becomes livable again. Let John chew on that.
Lee Benke, and just a question. In Robert Alter's translation of Genesis, which I taught a bit at the University of Chicago, doesn't he mention that Abraham was saved during the destruction because he was a righteous man? And then it adds, and he walked with God.
That's right.
Which sort of backs up what you're saying, this motion.
That's right. That's right. Although, as you know, in Genesis 15, there is a famous text around which the whole Reformation turned that says Abraham trusted God and it was reckoned to him as righteousness. So that particular verse, he didn't even do anything. He was just allied with the reality of God. So, yes.
Yeah.
Right. And as you know, in Genesis 18, where it says that about Abraham, Abraham kind of scolds God.
Right.
Should not the just judge do justice? No. Come on now.
Thank you so much, Colin Diver. So you talked about, you took a nice, good-natured swipe at Trinity.
I allowed myself.
Well, okay.
I aligned myself with that. It wasn't a,
I know you do. I know you do, because you're a part of this market culture, too.
That's right. No. Indeed. Please buy those books.
You know what? I think you've just answered my question. Okay, keep the Sabbath, you say. But what about the other 6 days? We're driven by, we're captured by the market economy, most of us. Not everybody in this room, most of us, I confess. So how do I keep from being a hypocrite?
Well, the first step, as you recognize, is to be honest. But then to keep at the question, which isn't easy or obvious, what steps can I take otherwise? And some people will take only baby steps, but every once in a while, somebody will take a serious step. Millard Fuller, who founded Habitat, just divested his money. You know, I'm not recommending heroic action, but it may come to that, and so on and so on. I think this way of reading the Bible means to put us in contradiction, and then we have to keep working at that contradiction. No one knows for any of us how it comes out. So thank you for that. The voice of realism.
Yep. Hi, I'm Patty Griesmer, and I agree, it is hard to live in this world and be a part of the world, but to be set apart. And as you were talking and as I was thinking about some of the questions, people that come to mind me as examples are Daniel. He prayed 3 times a day, even when he was, you know, going to be thrown into the lion's den. He sought God's counsel. And then in Luke 2, verse 25, we read about Simeon, who was called to stay at the temple day and night, yep, praying. And Anna, after she was a widow, and she was in her 80s, and she was widowed after 7 years of marriage. And I'm not called to stay at the temple day and night. I'm married. We have a life. We have children, grandchildren. But I am impressed that these people were so wanting to hear from God. And the Holy Spirit was upon Simeon, it tells us. And I want that. So how do I figure it out? Well, I can't. But through prayer, yep, and being in the presence of God and walking with God and seeking God through prayer, fasting, or spiritual disciplines. Another book that I like about spiritual disciplines is by Adele Calhoun. And she talks about spiritual disciplines, yep, for, yep, Christians today. And I think that's the only way I can sort of scratch the surface to find my way.
Yeah, yeah. I thank you for that. I think it really pivots on the awareness that it's hard for all of us who have grown up in a very accommodationist culture that the gospel is really about an alternative life. And people like us do not know how to get there. But it is a big conversation in our life. Yes.
Hi, my name is Victoria Gimbel. I have a question. In the story of Joseph, God commanded the Jews to live as exiles. And my question is it possible that is not, that being an exile is just the first step in defining their lives, and it's really a story about self-discovery, and the next step is to become a Christian.
Yes, yes. Let me make a comment about Joseph, though. You know, Joseph became Pharaoh's food czar. And the amazing thing about Joseph, when the peasants came and asked for food, it never occurred to him to give them food, because he had signed on with Pharaoh. So there is a scholar at the University of Chicago, he's a very conservative scholar, who says that Joseph had become Egyptianized. Now the question that you raise is, could Joseph have been Pharaoh's food czar and done it differently? And of course we don't know. Maybe he couldn't. But then maybe he shouldn't have been the food czar. But maybe he could have. Yeah. So Joseph is a good example about how the dominant ideology co-opts people. Co-opts people so deeply that we don't remember who we were, even though we are sealed as Christ's own forever. Yeah. Thank you. There's two hands over here.
Hi, I'm Nene Diana, and I took a very long sabbatical from the church, and I only came back because I have a 9-year-old, and she started singing in the choir, and I really didn't have a whole lot of interest in any of it, and I can't quote any part of the Old Testament like most people here can. I think the last time I read it was in 8th grade. So what I'm struggling with is, well, A, is there any particular place in the Old Testament that I could point to where children are setting the example? I like to lead by example rather than giving her a lot of words. And, you know, I'm having a hard time getting her to pay attention to a sermon, regardless of how enthralling I may think they are,
or you may not think they are.
Oh no, I think they're great. And I always ask her if she pays attention, but I'm, you know, this is big stuff to try and teach a 9-year-old. So I'm sort of, and I'm not wholly convinced by all of it all the time anyway. So, you know, I'm trying to sort of struggling with that. That's not really a question.
Yeah. That's a statement. Well, I'll respond to it anyway. I am no childhood educator, and maybe some of you want to speak to it, but I would say what we have to do with our young children is to flood them with stories. Flood them with spectacular stories, because in Exodus 12 and 13, around the Passover, what Moses or whoever wrote that says, you shall go blah, 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 all this strange stuff about horseradish and I don't know what. In order that your children will say to you, why are we doing this? And then you shall tell them the story of our emancipation. So I think our children sometimes are gripped by the stories that we have come to trust. And those stories do not need explaining, they do not need justifying, they just need to be told. And we got a lot of them. And they're outrageous. You know, the little boy that came home, he said, what'd you learn in school? He said, I learned that Moses built pontoon bridges across the Red Sea and people walked out. The mother said, I don't think that's likely. She said, well, you don't think it's likely what they told me either. So biblical Biblical faith does not proceed by explanation. It proceeds by wonder. So I would think of it, I said this a bit yesterday, I would think of the Bible as a family album. And you want your daughter, you want your daughter to see all these strange people that populate our story. So let me tell you about Abraham. And we should tell them unvarnished, not that they're great spiritual heroes, but they're really conniving, manipulating, dishonest people. The word of the Lord, thanks be to God.
I'm partly responsible for making sure that you don't feel trapped when you've committed yourself to a particular time, but I'm also committed as the director of overseeing Christian formation to recognize that the director of children's ministries in our midst, and that we in children's ministries use godly play as part of our curriculum, where the central question that children are taught to ask is, I wonder what Moses thought when he lifted his staff. I wonder what, and I might say it's not a bad question for adults, I wonder, and I think follows along the line that you've just suggested, Dr. Brueggemann.